I was delivered into this world near the shores of Lake Erie in Cleveland, Ohio. My mother, Anna Anguillano, and my father, Angelo DeLauro, are first-generation Italian-Americans. All four of my grandparents were born in Italy, from the same town, Ascoli Satriano, near Foggia, in Puglia. Now, two generations later, I've often asked myself, where do I come from? Why don't I speak the Italian language? How am I linked to distant families? What is this culture that left an indelible mark on my soul?
Over the years, my father told me several family stories, but one in particular is the seed that germinated into this documentary. In the fields outside of Ascoli Satriano near Foggia, my maternal grandmother, Filomena de Muro, a young and very attractive woman, was working in the fields harvesting lampascone, a small bitter onion. My fraternal great-grandmother, Chieta di Laro, served as my grandmother's field boss. At one point, my great-grandmother proclaimed, "Filomena, listen to the bagpipes. It must be the shepherds from Abruzzo. Go up the hill and give them the eye, and maybe they'll give us some cheese." That was almost 100 years ago, and a lot has happened since then. All of my grandparents immigrated to the United States in the early 1920s to better their lives from the miseria of southern Italy. My parents grew up during the Great Depression and World War II. Their generation tried desperately to become Americans, buying into the notion of the melting pot theory, which eliminates cultural diversity.
La storia della transumanza ha un inizio molto antico, infatti risale all'epoca del bronzo, XVI-XVII secolo a.C. Però un impulso molto forte lo ebbe nell'epoca romana, in quanto i romani consideravano la pastorizia un'arte nobile. Successivamente andò sempre più sviluppandosi, ma chi diede veramente il via ad una utilizzazione della pastorizia, possiamo dire in maniera moderna, furono i Normanni che all'inizio del XV secolo istituirono un regolamento denominato Dogana di Foggia, Regio Decreto della Dogana di Foggia.
In the city of Peltuinum, there is a tratturo, a shepherd's trail, where the shepherds used to migrate from this area down to Puglia, and they would go to Foggia. And the city became important more in the 15th century, when it became an economical resource for this area, and shepherds come through the doors of Peltuinum to pay their taxes and graze their sheep there.
So there's an entire network created of what are called tratturo, which are trails. These things can be 100 meters wide. I mean, these herd, we have to imagine herds that up to, I mean, we're talking about 3 million sheep moving. So these are not small trails. They can start small, but they eventually will broaden as more herds feed into the trails.
Il trattore vuol dire era la strada primitiva, che questa strada qua c'era un mercato di mestieri che spostavano questi famosi animali e giravano sul trattore. Il trattore veniva sempre dall'Abruzzo, che poi veniva in Puglia, poi andava in Basilicata, andava in Campania. Questo era lo spostamento di questo animale.
I discovered connections between these ancient trails and the ones that led to the New World. And as a result, I linked people on both sides of the Atlantic who were looking to discuss and perhaps reevaluate their own identity with those of similar DNA.
Con la quale regolamentavano sia l'attività sia i transiti. Delle cose imparate dai pastori andando in Puglia e poi riprodotta in Abruzzo è stato quello dei trulli. Come tutti sanno, in Puglia esiste una antica tradizione di costruzioni rurali fatte in pietra secca e sono state riportate da noi e riprodotti con nome diverso e vengono chiamate pagliare. Pagliare ed erano luoghi di breve sosta dove i pastori si fermavano per riposare.
I grew up in the United States, I mean right here in Pittsburgh, but my dad really has one brother here. We don't have a lot of extended family. All my cousins and extended family is in Italy. So, but around that table, my dad made us understand who we were connected to there. So, on that note, when we got there for the first time, we knew who everybody was. All we had to do was attach the face with the name. And people were just shocked that I would know the stories and the nicknames of people. You know, everybody in my dad's town has a nickname. They call it sopranome. It's a name on top of your name, just to distinguish what family you belong to, or you know, it's usually by a trait, a big nose, a big nose, short pants. There was a guy in my dad's town that wore 100, well, not maybe not 100, but a lot of belts. And they used to call him Centofibbia, which is 100 belts. Well, when I got to Italy and said to my aunt, who never met me, where's Centofibbia? They were like...
I was going to see Rose, Freddie, everybody that live in Youngstown. Hey, it's a Pagendran people too. A lot of Pagendran is over there. It's Freddy, it's too, it's he's a nice man. When he's calling a telephone, he's a joke all the time. We talk, he's like a talk on the phone. Sometimes I say, you talk too much. It's
this the harmonica that I got for a gift from my mother-in-law. She went back to Italy in 1959. And she brought me back this. And I love them since. I still have them. How many years is it now? It's about 50 years. And it's a lost a little bit of air, it goes through a little bit, but I still have a memory. And when I play, I think about her.
Allora, prima di tutto, before we do anything else, have a drink.
Salute. like you say, I used to ride a telephone.
All the different.
So now the telephone is much easier.
Well, I used to ride too, but now I forget how to write.
Well, really, write.
Not English and not Italian anymore.
Really, need to teach you.
I forget both. So I get on the phone and call them on the phone.
I'll teach you how to write.
Oh, you can. They want you to go over there all the time. But nobody comes over here. Nobody wants to come over here.
You call,
but they don't call. I don't know why.
Yeah, they all do that.
Palazzi fabbricati a mondi d'ore.
Sono stato spesso in America. Ho avuto la fortuna di stare nel nord degli Stati Uniti spesso. E ho guardato, ho visto cose che magari leggevo nei libri, ho letto o leggevo nelle canzoni americane, perché grazie ai dischi, grazie alla radio, grazie alla televisione, ho avuto la fortuna di conoscere la cultura che nasceva in America.
Io mi ricordo quando ero piccola, che mi ricordo, mia nonna mi raccontava sempre che i suoi parenti più stretti sono emigrati per lavoro tanti anni fa, perché avevano esigenze di vivere, che qua non si stava poco. E poi sono andati in America, in Australia, e si hanno fatta la loro vita con le loro famiglie. E hanno qua stavano i genitori, però si sono sentite anche forse un po' abbandonati, però purtroppo la vita loro era là, che erano emigrate, erano trovati di meglio e stavano là.
Think about, there was no television then, no internet, no newspaper in these towns. Who were the communicators? How would the news travel from place to place? Well, the shepherd was the ambassador of telling, you know what happened in Abruzzo? There was an earthquake. And I heard there were many people died there. And they would say, really? It was an earthquake, yeah, in Abruzzo. So they were transmitter of news, as well as they will acquire the culture from the site where they were staying, bring it back to the town where they came from. So there was in the cultural activity movement among, that's reflected in the songs, in the poems, in the poetry, in the books they've written.
Quando la notte stavamo con le pecore per stabbiare i terreni, godevo i canti dei grilli in quelle notti stellate. Le stelle facevano da orologio. La stella dell'alba ci diceva: mungete le pecore, potete mungere. Le stelle gallinelle ci indicavano il mattino. Le gallinelle erano le prime che spuntavano all'alba del mese di giugno e del mese di luglio. Poi, dal primo di agosto, si cominciavano a vedere le stelle pecorelle e le stelle dell'alba a settembre. Queste stelle, mese per mese, ci dicevano: mungete le pecore. Quando uscivano queste stelle, si mungevano le pecore, perché d'estate si mungeva al fresco. Poi a ottobre ce ne andavamo nelle grotte della Valle dell'Orfento ed era uno spettacolo, perché lì l'erba era ancora buona e si stava magnificamente. Rimanevamo tutto il mese di ottobre alla grotta di San Benedetto, dove dormivamo insieme alle pecore, come facevano gli eremiti, che anche loro dormivano alle grotte. Dal primo di novembre riportavamo le pecore alla contrada e così finiva la stagione delle pecore in montagna e salutavamo le grotte degli eremiti e le stelle dell'estate.
Alla salute di tutti gli amici, tutti la famiglia di Scanto. Sì.
And they said, well, you're white. And I said, no, I'm Italian American. And they said, oh no. And I said, look, it's no different than the African American, the Asian American, the Native American. I said, I'm Italian American. I said, I'm 100% Italian.
Very strange that they say some Italo-Americans, they feel like Italians, but they can't speak Italian, not at all.
Just some words like
that. That's very weird. Even if you have your father from Italy, you can't speak Italian.
Yeah, but maybe their parents didn't want them to speak Italian. Maybe their parents themselves, they didn't speak in Italian anymore when they came here.
Yeah, that's true.
Tra italiani e italo-americani. Gli italoamericani sono un po' testoni. Sì, perché vogliono. Cioè, no, gli ragazzi nati là va bene, loro sono brava gente, ma gli italoamericani sono un po' troppo spavaldi. Ma non lo so, saranno perché stanno comodi, saranno perché quando sono partiti da qua hanno lasciato le miserie, poi là hanno trovato il benessere. Però loro poi dimenticano da dove vengono. Cioè, questo fa male. Cioè, uno deve, sì, anche se tu stai bene, cioè i soldi, però la patria è come la mamma. Se tu rinneghi la mamma, rinneghi la patria, rinneghi la mamma.
As soon as you know it, your life is over. It's a very short period of time, and what you pass on to your children is all you have. So with my three sons now having Italian citizenship and spending more time here, hopefully I'm leaving them some of the culture of my family's 200 or 300 years in this town. And getting that kind of history and connection down to my children and having it last would be something that would make my life make sense. You know, I've been able to clothe my kids and give them education, put them in a house, and think everybody wants to do for their kids, but, you know, leaving them without some sense of who they are and giving them something they can build on their own, I think is something most parents would really treasure if they could do it.
People who were coming from the mountains of Molise, Abruzzo, were essentially bringing their entire culture with them. They were essentially putting their culture on their backs and carrying it. Now, there was some mixing of culture in Puglia. I've heard that San Rocco, who was a saint very important in Puglia, is now important in Abruzzo because of this exchange.
Patron saint of Ascoli Satriano, the paese of my grandparents, is San Potito. In this small town in Puglia, a festival honoring the martyr and his donkey, La Festa dell'Asino del San Potito, is celebrated twice a year. When my grandparents and their friends immigrated to Northern Ohio back in the 1920s, they continued this tradition of honoring San Patito with their own celebrations, publicly recognizing and celebrating their bonds with the past and at the same time preserving the passage of tradition and culture to their families who either rejected or accepted these precious bonds to the motherland.
This is my father, Tony Zanzano. This is my mother, Marie. This is myself. This is my sister, Cindy. This is my sister, Tony. This is my cousin Linda, my cousin Sharon, my Aunt Harriet, my Uncle Sonny, my Aunt Phil.
Years ago, we had so many people leave the country for better opportunities, you know, and they found that in Cleveland. And that's why we have all these people here. These are the kids of the kids. We're talking about the fourth generation here.
It's all about tradition of us bringing the saint from the hometown, San Patito, and people really sacrificed to bring it. My one aunt even gave up her wedding band to raise money for it. And my father in Canton went to all his paisans to get money to bring the saint here.
Names again,
right,
and
right.
Know that we were there and have that.
And they're a part of, I mean, we're a part of each other's lives.
My dad wanted me to be born on San Patito, and he wanted to name me Patito, too. And my mother says, oh, no, you can't name your daughter that. So that's how I got the name of Clara then, because it was my grandmother's name.
Everybody lived there. Grandpa lived in the back, and there was a family in the front, and then there was,
Grandma,
other way.
Grandma and Grandpa lived in the
front.
Aunt Lee lived in the back.
Uncle
Roxy lived next door.
And
they had a lot was so.
The Italo-American here lives still with the memories. The memories are the memories of a mother, and the mother, she's far away. This mother's name is Italy. And when you arrive there, you understand something that is always in your blood, that we call ancestrale. It's something, this ancestrale, that you can explain.
Sometimes I feel like I'm in the same shoe, like with raising the sheep. I feel like this, like I'm going back in time, what they used to do, you know? Like sometimes I used to see Grandpa used to butcher his own lamb sometimes for the meat.
To understand why I was the way I was, when my father was the way he was, then to really get a grip on my grandfather, which was very important to me, was to master Italian, was to then go off the beaten path and go to where my people came from, Abruzzo. And if you don't speak Italian in Abruzzo, can I say you're SOL? You are nobody there. Very few people speak English. It's not like Florence. It's not like Rome. But you will find people who are compelled to talk to you.
It's funny because I have people come in, oh yeah, we're Italian, you know. Oh, but really, do you do that? No. Do you follow that? No. Oh, we don't do that. We don't like fish. You know, and it's just to say that they're Italian, but it's so diluted.
Hey.
Naturalmente sono in pochi quelli che riescono a capire i testi, che sono difficoltosi anche per gli italiani da comprendere perché cantati in dialetto. Nonostante questo arriva un'emozione forte e questa è una cosa che ci gratifica tantissimo, riuscire a comunicare proprio a livello emotivo quello che la nostra musica tiene dentro.
Most of the shepherds in my town, last name was Anguillano. So Michael's family is part of their family. Up to maybe 10 years ago, one of the Anguillanos was providing my parents with cheese ricotta, and they used to eat that all year round. Provolone, pecorino, and mozzarella. These were done by the Anguillano family.
Di capre e pecore, e questo è il mio mestiere. Facevo un po' l'agricoltore, un po' di tutto faccio. Ma questo mestiere, secondo me, fra un 30 anni, 50 anni, gli animali si devono vedere solo per televisione, perché purtroppo, come stiamo messi noi, cioè, perché il prodotto non c'è un valore, gli animali e la carne si vende sempre a basso costo, perché questa Europa che ci ha portato, secondo me ci porta alla miseria, ci porta a scomparire del tutto, sia nell'agricoltura, sia nella pastorizia, sia in tutti i lavori che stiamo facendo in questo mestiere qua.
I remember one time my grandpappy, he was passing by the farmer there, and he tipped his hat, and there was nobody around. And I said, "Grandpappy," I said, "what did you do that for?" "Why?" He said, "that's my compadre over there. He lives in a house." But I said, "You didn't see him. "Why?" He said, "I pay my respect. You know, I just wanted to salute him. There's nobody around." When we come over here at the time, we couldn't speak Italian. Just a dialect, you know what I mean?
That's it. That's dialect, it. That's exactly.
Now you go over there, if you talk the dialect, they look at you funny because they think, "Oh," I said, "what's the matter?"
Yeah. It's going to be disappeared.
Where do you come from?
Where do you come from?
Qualche tempo fa sono venuti, diciamo, nel 1960 praticamente, è venuto un cugino di mio padre che faceva il militare nel Foggiano, è venuto a trovarci questo cugino, insomma, che praticamente parlava inglese. Ma la cosa che più mi ha meravigliato è che parlava perfettamente il dialetto orsarese, non parlava l'italiano, ma il dialetto orsarese è come se, diciamo, non fosse mai andato in America, insomma, le parole proprio vecchie, tradizionali del dialetto orsarese, che forse oggi anche noi non ce le ricordiamo più, insomma. Proprio evidentemente perché i genitori, che erano andati da piccoli in America, parlavano questo dialetto stretto proprio orsarese, e quindi hanno tramandato anche ai figli qualche diverse parole, insomma, perché in famiglia forse spesso parlavano anche in dialetto, insomma, fra di loro.
Le persone che abbiamo incontrato nei nostri tour, una parte di loro, ma soprattutto le persone più anziane, restavano con un ricordo dell'Italia che riguardava forse 50 anni fa. Sono delle persone che comunque sono rimaste con un ricordo dell'Italia ben definito e legato nei luoghi in cui hanno vissuto, ma sono quei luoghi, insomma, sono di 50 anni, in 50 anni di cambiamenti ce ne sono stati.
She asked my father, that was her nephew, how about going to America with me? Because I don't want to go myself, I'm getting older and all that. And he says, well, I don't have the money. She said, you don't have to worry about the money. I have my godmother, she wants to sell her chooch, and she'll get the money and let you have it. Then when you get a job here in America, you can pay her back.
But the difference with us, we left Italy when we're still taught the old-fashioned way. The Italian in Italy now, they don't think the way we do. They don't have our tradition that we have either.
They moved on with their...
That's right.
They're evolving. They're evolving.
Yeah.
We're staying the same.
They're modern Italians.
No, it's the truth. They're not the same.
After almost 5 months that we are here, what do you think about cultural differences or all this stuff?
Cultural difference. Do you remember our first experience here when we go out from the airport, how everything looks big car, big parking lot, big spaces, big houses, big persons too.
Yes.
Yeah. Also.
E ce ne venne cinque, le belle là, Madonna e Santa Mirte. Fatti sciunne, sciunne in cantatore, in galata.
Io sono la mamma di Domenico e Ugo e sono orgogliosa di loro. Mi mancano tanto, li ho portati in America, erano ragazzini, hanno fatto tutto quello che hanno fatto da soli perché il padre purtroppo si è ammalato ed è morto e qua c'ho altri tre figli. E mi mancano tanto i miei figli perché l'ho lasciati che erano ragazzini e io purtroppo non è che ho fatto una vita tanto tranquilla, perché una famiglia separata, metà una parte, metà un'altra. Purtroppo non è che la salute non è che ce n'ho tanta. Comunque i figli miei sono orgogliosi di loro, di tutti e cinque. Specialmente loro che mi mancano molto perché ce l'ho lontani.
The whole street would be full of probably thousands of sheep, probably maybe 2,000, huh?
Oh, easy. You remember? Then yeah. We were mad because you couldn't play soccer anymore because the sheep are coming through there.
Yeah.
That's what we miss.
Who was the old man that...
Aquilino.
Aquilino, yeah. He lived in a little cave.
What's Aquilino means, the name Aquilino? Remember Aquilino?
I mean, Aquilino means like a...
Eagle, right? Aquila.
Small eagle. So, yeah,
remember?
Like that. And I never forget one day, my grandmother was... She lived in Caramanico. Remember grandmother?
Yeah.
Yeah, uh-huh. And she was making homemade noodles. And so I said, why don't we bring him some, you know, because he's all by himself. And he criticized that her noodle wasn't good enough because she makes it better. It was so funny.
The singing in parts that went on in the fields in order to make its drudgery, its back-breaking work, and to pass the time of day. I don't know if you're familiar with quel mazzolin di fiori, which is a call response type of singing, went on all day long. There would be a strong voice, a male voice or a female voice, that would start out with quel mazzolin di fiori, and then the entire assembly of people would answer, che vien dalla montagna. And again, quel mazzolin di fiori, che vien dalla montagna. E bada ben che non si bagna, che lo voglio regalare. Bada ben che non si bagna,
che lo voglio regalare.
Dicevo che però la transumanza non si limitava soltanto a una migrazione, a uno spostamento utilitaristico, se vogliamo, delle greggi, ma allora i pastori erano molto colti. Non sapevano forse leggere e scrivere, però sapevano a memoria la Divina Commedia, l'Orlando Furioso, e cioè la Gerusalemme liberata, cioè tutti questi poemi, sapevano anche i Vangeli a memoria, intendiamoci.
Cosa ho fatto perché io non siamo nemici?
The restaurants, the market, all the places, the alimentari, which are the food shops, the salumerie, the salami shops, they're gone. And unfortunately, as things now stand, with that area being the heart being ripped out of it, I really am very fearful. Abruzzo is beautiful. Abruzzo is culturally vibrant and wonderful. But Abruzzo doesn't have the sort of documented cultural patrimony of Florence or Assisi. If something happens in Florence, the whole world kicks in and they rebuild it. Abruzzo doesn't have the capo lavori, the masterworks of Michelangelo or Da Vinci. And what I fear is that they're never going to really try to sort of recreate, for lack of funds. I mean, I think the Abruzzesi would love to try, but I think Italy's government, the world as a whole, is not going to, I fear, pony up and do what's necessary to sort of bring all that back. Because they don't even know what's been lost. To them, it's a sad story they read in the paper and they've moved on. To us, where we live, we lived in L'Aquila for 6 months. And that experience changed our lives.
You go there today, nobody's a shepherd. They're ashamed of it. It's like a sin.
These people, they used to feed the people. They didn't have the sheep. They kept looking down those people because they were good people, they were hard work people. The one didn't have the sheep, they're most a little bit lazy because they don't want to do the work.
Allora, oggi la pastorizia è un sacrificio. Non è pagata per il lavoro che noi facciamo, perché qua non esistono le feste, non esistono giorni di pioggia, è sempre da lavorare, tutti i giorni di tutto l'anno. Io lo faccio perché ho investito la mia vita e dei soldi per fare questo allevamento qua. E mo non mi posso fermare, e poi un po' ci sta la passione che dai nostri nonni, mio padre, cose che lo facevano, e noi continuiamo finché possiamo.
Che partiva dall'Abruzzo, scendeva nelle Puglie e in modo particolare nella parte nord del Tavoliere, quindi Foggia, Ascoli Satriano, Ortanova, queste zone qui. Certamente, vivendo dal mese di ottobre circa fino a giugno, prendevano molto della cultura di ogni tipo, soprattutto la cultura religiosa, da queste zone e la portavano poi nei loro paesi. E non è escluso che abbiano fatto anche questo a proposito della Madonna Nera. Ripeto, perché la provincia di Foggia era molto rinomata per la transumanza, e quindi facilmente, vivendo a contatto con questa realtà, con questa devozione, poiché era gente pia, gente di fede.
And the smell. When I went to my cousin's house for the first time in Italy, I could smell my grandmother's house. And every time I go there now, and I know I was there last year with my daughter and my wife, I said, remember when we walk in this hallway, take a bunch of deep breaths, because this is what your grandmother's house smelled like. And so, you know, it's important to know where we come from. I mean, it just boosts who we are. I mean, it's all about you search for identity. Well, you can't much search for identity if you don't take it back as far as you can take it.
In the Italo-American culture, the sense of the madre is the first one, is the sense of the life, is the sense of the first thing that we taste in this life is the milk of the breast of our mother.
Ma a Pasqua si andava, quando arrivava il caldo, si portava sopra i terreni che si coltivavano, che noi avevamo i terreni che si coltivavano là. Quando era bel caldo, quelle belle serate, quel cielo stellato, si portavano sopra i terreni e a fare quello stabio. Allora dove dormivano le pecore? Dopo, a ottobre, si seminava il grano. L'anno dopo, quando si faceva la raccolta di quel grano, caro mio, era un grano bello, giallo, color d'oro, dove dormivano le pecore, bello era quel grano.
L'abitudine, Luca mi ha detto che è diverso di qua. Però in tante cose si mangia bene pure là. Giustamente la cucina italiana è un po' meglio. Come caffè, come fettuccine, come agnello.
I think food is a window on culture. Food is a door that opens anyone who's sort of observant and receptive up to a culture.
Same story with my roommate. He told me, okay, you are Italian, so you know chicken parmigiana. Of course I don't know, because it's not an Italian plate.
Do you remember what happened one time during the first week in the food court, when I asked for a hamburger, and the guy of the shop didn't understand. So he said, hey kid, what do you want? I want an hamburger. What an hamburger? What? The first one in the list. Oh boy, you want an hamburger.
The tradition is such that they don't pasteurize their milk. And so these cheeses are very often eaten relatively quickly, and they're very fresh. One, they're extremely fresh, and plus, because the pasteurization destroys a lot of the flavor of the milk, because the milk carries with it all those flavors from all those herbs. I mean, you have a sheep eating wild oregano, and then these grasses, you can taste that in the milk. You can taste that in the cheeses.
Sometimes, remember, we used to pack lunch, and we used to go up on the mountains, and we used to put bread with olive oil and sliced tomato and salt and pepper, and it would be our sandwich. You know, it was so good. And sometimes with used to put chocolate spread on top.
Oh, yeah, la chocolate.
Yeah, it was like a treat, you know.
Yeah, if we had the chocolate, but when we have chocolate, what would we put on the bread?
Oh, a little bit of wine and sugar.
If we didn't have the wine, what would we put in? Water and sugar?
Water and sugar. It was good too.
There was a snack, water and sugar on a slice of bread.
I forget that.
That was it, pane e zucchero, remember? It was like, oh man, it was that good, you know?
Yep.
We were all talking and eating and laughing and, you know, chatting,
it's around the table. So memories are made around the table, and things are taught around the table.
Mamma ha preparato per Michele un po' di, diciamo, alimenti che si usavano una volta, cioè i troccoli fatti ancora con...
Michele, come possiamo dire, con il mattarello, no? I troccoli...
Mattarello, diamolo.
Spaghetti...
Alla chitarra, no? Alla chitarra. Sì. Poi assaggeranno la salsiccia.
Michele.
La salsiccia, ecco, oh, questi sono...
Troccoli.
I troccoli. Ecco, puoi prenderne uno, questi qua, ecco qua, spaghetti troccoli,
troccoli
fatti in casa.
Vado a fotografare.
In casa?
Sì,
chiamo
a fotografare.
Poi,
aspetta che mi fa la fotografia.
Dimmi che cosa ancora, quindi troccoli col sugo, poi gli farà della salsiccia e delle mozzarelle che si usavano una volta. Quindi tutti i prodotti genuini.
Each one of the sheep in my brother's flock had a name, and that sheep responded to the name, knew the name, so that if he called her Betta, she would turn around and she knew. So all those Bible stories that make the analogy between the Good Shepherd and the sheep were very, very meaningful. And it was not something that was in some old book or something that they talked about in church. It was a lived experience for us.
Attività di pastorizia, e i cani pastori abruzzesi e i cani paladori fanno il loro lavoro per aiutare i pastori del posto. Quindi i cani paladori sono i cani paladori che girano le pecore e le fanno riportare al pastore, mentre i pastori abruzzesi fanno il lavoro che guardano il territorio e guardano i greggi e si mettono in alto dalle colline, dalle montagne, per guardare soltanto il gregge. Quindi sono di difesa contro il lupo, sono una difesa contro il lupo e fanno il lavoro loro. Quindi ognuno fa il suo lavoro. Il pastore fa quello, il cane suo fa quello, il cane paratore fa quell'altro, ognuno fa il suo lavoro.
Quando fischia, per esempio, che fai... Allora il cane viene e aspetta gli ordini che tu gli dai, no? Poi magari se fai un altro fischio e fai... Allora il cane va intorno agli animali, li accodisci, li raccoglie.
E mi è capitato anche un altro amico mio, un altro allevatore, che ce l'aveva durante la notte dentro al recinto. Sono saltati 7 lupi dentro al recinto. 2 hanno portato via i cani, hanno fatto l'esche per i cani e 5 hanno ammazzato 27-30 capi di animali. E qui fanno dei danni e dopo per prendere i soldi ci vuole 1 anno, 2 anni, non è che ci pagano subito, perché la burocrazia è lunga, la provincia ci paga, la provincia, però ci vuole, dobbiamo, oltre al danno dobbiamo anche attendere tanto.
Ogni Natale, we play Nonno Pietro's old bagpipe records, the ones he hid under his coat until he played them for Nonna so she wouldn't be angry that he'd spent one whole day's wage for la novena di Natale con Ciaramella, and another's for Pastorale con Ciaramella, and still another's for Tu scendi dalle stelle con Ciaramella. Ogni Natale, I place the bagpipe player figurine outside the presepio stable door for Gesù Bambino's sweet serenade. I bought this rosy-cheeked player at the Piazza Navona fair that swirled and pulsed with bagpipe music on cassette. Ogni Natale, I recall the December day I followed wind-blown bagpipers down Rome's fashion-lit streets in tears of longing and tears of joy, awed by the skill and moved by the songs. Ogni Natale, I remember the Christmas Eve, I stood on stark Sicilian mountains, listening with full heart to the yearning ancient sound of three bagpipes in procession. Clear as the nighttime air, brilliant as the Mediterranean stars, profound as the blue-black sky. Ogni Natale I can know again and understand exactly why Nonno Pietro paid his wages of toil and his wages of pain to hear La Sciaramella's plaintive voice.
This story is my attempt to make up for lost time and, more importantly, reestablish the familial path that has been neglected and abandoned for two generations. On the Dallaro side of my family, Nonno Nunzio left Italy in 1921 and never returned. Even when his mother was dying and living in squalor, he chose not to go home. My grandmother, Filomena Anguilano, witnessed these conditions when she visited Ascoli Saturdano in 1960. Nunzio's lack of compassion or commitment for his own mother, Chieta, was reinforced with stories about his selfishness and mean spirit as told on many occasions by my father, Angelo. Fifty years after Nunzio's death, I still harbor a disdain for my grandfather when I think about his decision to sever the ties from his mother, who nourished him to life. To compound the saga, my father, Angelo, always said he'd love to go back, but could never find his path to the land and the people who came before him. I believe if my mother, Anna Anguilano, had not passed over 25 years ago, she would have led the pilgrimage with my father in tow without any fanfare. So with this documented history created by my grandfather and my father, I came to the realization it had to be me who sets the record straight. It must be me who reconstructs the familial trail from America back to Ascoli Satriano. And once I set that expedition in motion, I was thrilled that my wife Jan and my sister Angela and her two sons Sean and Graham wanted to be part of this odyssey.
Camilla, where's your papa?
Si.
Mio papa. Si. Anguilano Michele.
And Valentina, what does it say over it? What does it say underneath?
Fuggi.
Solamente come un soffio la vita gli sfuggi, senza un lamento, lasciando un vuoto incolmabile in tutti coloro che lo amavano. Anguilano Michele, nato nel 22 settembre 1910, è morto il 17 dicembre 1910.
The time I was walking through the cemetery with Carmela and Rosetta, it was a strange feeling to see the names of my great-grandparents on tombstones. And that's when I really felt a connection to them because we came from the same place.
All of them have embraced putting faces, places, and people in towns together with their heritage. Angela and Graham have spent time with La Familia twice. Sean spent a semester in Rome and stayed on to help me with his production in 2011. So I was no longer alone. I had the support that created lasting relationships and a moving legacy from Abruzzo to Puglia.
When my great-aunt, Maria Doloro, said that she felt abandoned by my great-grandpa when he went to America and never returned, when we came to visit her, I really felt that we were filling a hole in her heart.
Our dad always told us, watch, stay away, don't take nothing from nobody. Remember that, huh?
Yeah. He said, always said in this, in this country is a good country, but watch, if you're weak, you get lost.
Yeah.
And maybe that's something we all lose sometimes as you become more Americanized.
Trapped in a rhythm which doesn't belong to us, in my opinion. A rhythm which is stressful, which has nothing to do with what we were accustomed to doing when we lived in close contact and touch with nature, with our countryside, with our fields, with our harvests. I remember when I was a child, harvest was a feast.
E vorrei che tanti miei figli facessero un po' le nostre abitudini di campagna, di lavoro, di casa, diciamo. Però se non vogliono, però mi piacerebbe che loro non finisse la tradizione di noi genitori.
Although I've been to Italy several times and have visited both sides of my family, I'm still not quite sure how exactly I'm related to these gracious and compassionate people. My belief is that they share the same sentiment. Although we may have common surnames, there are discernible gaps in our family tree. However, each time I visit them, I'm always treated like la familia. My suspicion is that both sides are willing to take a leap of faith in order to keep the familial connection, nourishing our appetites and our souls with the underlying truth that we're all brothers and sisters carrying a trace of common blood.
Poi devi sapere una cosa, questo è importante per te, Michele. Mamma aveva un altro fratello. Il cui nome era Nunzio. Aveva 22-23 anni, partì in guerra nel 43, mamma, era la seconda guerra mondiale?
Sì.
E la nave partita da Grado, quindi Trieste, Grado, dopo poche ore,
Pola, e
affondata. Dopo poche ore fu bombardata, giusto?
Sì, era cannoniere.
Sì, era cannoniere lui, quindi sulla nave, dopo poche ore di viaggio dalla nave, fu affondata questa nave. Quindi mia madre ha perso un fratello di nome Nunzio a 22 anni.
Nunzio Di Lauro. Sta in piazza, dici che è
certo.
Sta Di Lauro Nunzio.
This is when I went to a dinner in Ascoli Satriano to meet family. Me and Ivana had to connect because I don't speak Italian and she barely speaks English. And I knew that I had to ask simple questions just because I felt awkward, and I'm sure she felt awkward as well.
Come ti chiami?
My name is Graham Nelly.
Dove
abiti? I'm from Cleveland, Ohio. It's about 6 o'clock, I think. Yeah.
Quanti anni
hai? No. I'm 16. My birthday is in March. I don't know. Marzo, is that it?
What is your name?
My name is Yvonne.
Brava, Yvonne.
When is your birthday?
My birthday is 19 July.
How old are you?
Thirteen. Mia nonna con Michele sono parenti, sono cugini e oggi vederli insieme mi fa tanta gioia. E Michele mi ha fatto una collana che viene dall'Africa e una maglia dell'America. Sono contenta di vivere questa giornata con voi.
Knowing that we are related allows us to knock on a door that has Doloro on it and hop in the car and go to lunch. And for today, I did not know I had a cousin in Milan or that I even had other cousins here. Just one più grande famiglia.
Big family.
Beh, io fino a poco fa non sapevo di avere parenti anche oltreoceano e sono contenta di averlo scoperto. E penso che sia importante che anche se la nostra famiglia è già grande di nostro si possa ampliare ancora di più, e anche se io conosco solo Sean e Michael.
Però trovo che many nice people, everyone is very friendly except drivers, and I am so lucky to meet family here and lifetime friends, and it's nothing like I thought it was going to be. It's way better.
Io sono felice di aver conosciuto Sean, tuo fratello e anche tua mamma l'anno scorso, e penso che sia una cosa molto molto bella riuscire a avvicinare i rapporti. Nonostante siamo distanti ed abbiamo mentalità, modi, abitudini e di vita diverse e anche di linguaggio, visto l'inglese e italiano. Però credo che anche con via mail o anche con Skype ci si possa sentire e riuscire a conoscere l'uno dell'altro.
Una saluta a te, la famiglia di Laura.
Perché è importante, sì, è importantissimo, perché è chiaro che queste persone riescono ad apprezzare
comunque i nostri fratelli che sono dovuti partire per l'America per lavoro. Noi li pensiamo sempre, stanno là in America e quindi si sono dovuti aggregare ad una cultura. Nuova cultura. Ed è importante che chi è dovuto andare via torni per conoscere le proprie radici.
Mio padre inizialmente aveva le capre. E quindi si usciva la mattina al pascolo. Io ricordo che di prima mattina si andava a mungere, poi si ritornava e si andava a vendere il latte. Quando era che faceva freddo, le mattinate proprio che c'era la neve, mi ricordo che mia madre preparava il pancotto. E quindi si mangiava tutti insieme il pancotto con il peperoncino piccante.
Mentre oggi mamma è felice di incontrare Michele,
no, è perché, mo la
perché si è unita la famiglia di nuovo, oggi con questi mezzi, con l'aereo, in un solo giorno, in poche ore, si riesce a stare insieme. Michele è riuscito a incontrarsi con mamma ed è una felicità. Michele ovviamente è il nonno di Nunzio, mentre mamma è la figlia di Luigi. Tutto qua, questa è la parentela.
Mio papà.
Tutto qua, questo.
Michele, l'ha vista.
Mi dispiace di non aver fatto meglio.
As I travel these iconic trails, I realize La Mia Strada has yielded a fruitful connection of family and friends on both sides of the ocean. This link has changed me. I now understand how the familial gaps of history and perception of ethnic identity are always evolving. This experience has burrowed a place in my soul that is now full of tangible meaning, discernible understanding, and realistic links to who I am. Those I met along the way guided me. They showed me insight. They gave me direction and pierced my heart with drops of common blood and shared humanity. Ultimately, the spirit of this journey is now eternally tethered to my soul. And the lesson I learned was to reconcile with my past in order to understand who I am. This has been my road, La Mia Strada.
Thanks to this story, thanks to this strada, you understand a lot of things and a lot of people now discover all the memory that were under the dust of their own soul.
Gabriele D'Annunzio, I think that's the name. Do you recall Gabriele D'Annunzio?
Yeah, he made a song.
La poesia. La poesia. Yeah. Poem.
Yeah, you remember la poesia?
Ne poco.
Ne poco.
Do you recall?
Oggi, la terra d'Abruzzi, right?
Oggi andiamo, i miei pastori lasciano, come si dice?
Lasciano i spazi e vanno verso il mare.
Dell'Adriatico, no, vanno verso il mare, verso l'Adriatico selvaggio. Ah, non mi ricordo, I don't remember.
I pastori di Gabriele D'Annunzio. Settembre, andiamo, è tempo di migrare. Ora in terra d'Abruzzi i miei pastori lasciano gli stazzi e vanno verso il mare. Scendono all'Adriatico selvaggio, che verde è come i pascoli dei monti. Han bevuto profondamente ai fonti alpestri, che sapor d'acqua natia rimanga nei cuor esuli a conforto. Che lungo illuda la lor sete in via, rinnovato hanno verga d'avellano, e vanno per trattura antico al piano, quasi per un'erba al fium silente, sulle vestigia degli antichi padri. O voce di colui che primamente conosce il trimolar della marina. Ora lunghesso il litoral cammina la greggia, senza mutamento è l'aria. Il sole in bionda silla viva lana, che quasi dalla sabbia non divaria, isciacquio, calpestio, dolci romori. Ah, perché non sono io coi miei pastori?
Sì, c'è, sì.